Today, more than any other day of the year, we celebrate life. He is risen. More than any other day this morning, we celebrate joy. He is risen. And on this special occasion, remembering the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we celebrate hope. He is risen. And our hope and our joy and our very life stand in direct opposition of the most taboo topic in our culture, death. Did you know that according to the U.S. Census Bureau, there are 107 deaths per minute worldwide? That comes out to about 153,000 deaths per day and over 56 million deaths per year. Wars only serve to increase that exponentially. Ben Franklin said, "Nothing is certain in this world but death and taxes." Yesterday was tax day. And according to the Bible, death came into the world through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. We also read that it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment. Quite simply, there is 100% certainty that every one of us will face death. We will die, unless we are part of that happy generation that experiences the rapture. Yet even with the certainty that every one of us will face death, we still fear death. We fear death because we fear what is associated with death. We fear the pain and the suffering that we have noticed accompany death often. We fear the unknown, the loss of control because we cannot control death. We fear the well-being of our loved ones after we die. Some of us fear going out of existence. We fear eternal punishment. We've developed an entire vocabulary around the topic of death, at least in this culture, because when someone dies, we use specific phrases when speaking of them. Oh, they have passed away. Or we say that they're now deceased. Or they're no longer with us. They've gone on to the next life, or hopefully they've gone to heaven. They've gone to a better place. It's hard for us to say, they died. We don't like that. That's too cold. It's too harsh. It's too blunt. We seldom talk about burying the dead. Instead, we say we're laying them to rest. Or we speak of their interment, don't we? Or attending their final services. Even insurance companies have a developed vocabulary for death. I've experienced this personally. When you go to have your last will and testament done, right? They talk about the value of survivor's insurance for our loved ones because they survived what we didn't, at least for a little bit. And how important is it to consider our policy has a clause in it that ensures assistance with final expenses. Wow. And estate planning is nothing more than a nice way of saying we're arranging for the disposal of our belongings before we die. We're all going to die. And in our contemporary culture, death has taken a new precedence, because we've trivialized through overexposure the macabre and unreal phenomena of zombies, the walking dead. as though such relentless exposure is somehow going to soften the trauma of death. I'll never forget my son's wedding day. After the ceremony and everything and the reception, he and Rachel were going to spend an evening in a beautiful hotel downtown St. Paul, and it happened to be the night of the zombie crawl. I'm sorry, I'm kind of out of touch. I didn't even know they had zombie crawls. The entire downtown area was filled with these freaks all looking like dead people. And I was at a stoplight, and I proceeded when it turned green, and somebody hadn't made it across the street fast enough, and she was really looking kind of strange. And she just slammed my car and said, you know, I don't want to say what she said to me. But, you know, we have trivialized death as though it's not that big of a thing. It is a big thing. It's the next step after this life. And it's frightening. It's very frightening. It doesn't ease the knowledge that death is final, nor can it. People seldom die in their homes today. More often than not, they're in a hospital or a hospice or a nursing home when their moment comes. And almost immediately, they're swept away by the funeral home and prepared for their final viewing. In fact, at the mortuary, it's their job to do their best to remove every visage of death and to make the person look natural and like they're asleep. I've lived all over the world. I've seen death in its rawest forms. Often they have the funeral within 3 days because of bloating and because of what happens to a body when it dies, and they don't have funeral homes in other places in the world. And you're just confronted with the awfulness of death. Other indicators in our culture that we don't like the fact that death is inevitable can be seen in the fervor over health care. How will we be taken care of if we become sick? Because we know sickness can lead to death. And the cosmetic industry, wow, $10.5 billion a year to dye our hair, whiten our teeth, tighten our sagging skin, all found in a little bottle, all through the magic world of cosmetics. What are we afraid of? Death. Because with age comes death. You say, well, this is an uplifting sermon, Pastor. I don't mean to be morose, but I do want you to face the facts. We're all going to die. Such things scream out the incessant desire for us to look young. We don't want to die. Who wants to die? Nobody wants to die. I'd like to tell you how the Bible deals with death, and it's summed up in one word, resurrection. That's why this is such a joyous day. I'll tell you what, it has nothing to do with an Easter bunny and eggs. Nothing at all. I don't even know, well, you know, there's all sorts of thoughts where that stuff came from. But this day is about Jesus Christ, a man who is God, that lived, offered himself voluntarily on the cross to die for our sins, and 3 days after his death, he rose again from the dead as God's stamp of approval that his death was satisfactory to pay for our sins so that we might rise with newness of life and have eternal life as well. That's what this day is about. And in order to really understand and maybe to help us rejoice even more than we're rejoicing, I thought it's good to talk a little bit about death. We need to understand. There's a contrast here, life and death. You know, in Matthew 28, we read, now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave, and behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. And his appearance was like lightning, meaning he was bright. And his clothing was white as snow. And the guards, they shook for fear of him and became like dead men. That's what happens when you see an angel. And the angel said to the women, don't be afraid, because that's what happens when you see an angel too. If you don't act like a dead man, you're terrible, just terrified. Don't be afraid, for I know you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified, and he is not here, for he has risen, just as he said. It's staggering if you read about the last weeks and months of Christ's life. He told them repeatedly that he was going to raise from the dead. Whew. Right over the top of their head. And the angel said, he is not here, for he is risen. Just as he said, come see the place where he was lying. Well, this morning I just want to look at four points to help us grasp this. The origin of death as a result of sin. Then we want to move into the origin of life, because it is the gift of God. And we want to look at the resurrection of Jesus Christ as a guarantee of eternal life for us. And finally, I just want to talk about the implications of the resurrection. It is courage and hope, and we need courage and hope today. We really need it more than we've ever needed it before. In the very first record of time, we find about the origin of death. In the Garden of Eden, God told Adam and Eve, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die. He warned them, he told them, that death would be theirs if they disobeyed him. But when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate. She gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. And so it was at the very beginning of time, death came into the world. Sin entered the world, and death came through sin. It came through disobedience to a clear command from God. It's inextricable in its relationship with sin. Death is a result of sin. It's important to understand that it's a judgment for sin that we die. And so therefore, every cemetery that you see and every loved one that you've lost is a testimony to the veracity of the Word of God. It just shouts out, we're all going to die. And it's sobering, and it should be sobering. Now, death in the Bible can mean physical death, which is what we're mostly aware of. When somebody dies, something happens, and this becomes a shell, and something's missing, right? The sense is cold, waxy, no response, nobody's home. They've died. But there's spiritual death as well, a separation of the human soul from God. Death means separation. Whether it means the soul from the physical body, that's physical death, or whether it means the soul being separate from God, that's spiritual death. And if by chance a person experiences physical death while they are still spiritually dead and separate from God, they will experience the third meaning of death in the Scripture, eternal death, the second death, from which there is no return. That means you die and your soul, who is separate from God because of sin, remains separate from God throughout the rest of eternity. That's spiritual death. It's the second death. So you've got physical death, spiritual death, and finally, eternal death. Now, although Adam and his wife, even after they died spiritually, when they ate of the tree, because in that day God said you would die, they died spiritually first, and eventually they died physically, right? It's like if you chop off a branch of a tree and hang it up in your house, it looks green and fine and everything. This happens especially in springtime when we get flowers and, you know, nice bushes that are flowering. I think of lilacs. And you put them up. But it's not long that you realize, oh, that thing is not alive. It's dead, because everything starts falling apart and it gets brown and it dies. Why? Because it's separate from its source of life. That's what spiritual death is. Our souls are separate from spiritual life that God gives us. And if we're separate like that spiritually and we die physically, we remain separate from God for all eternity. That is frightful, actually. From that moment on, Adam and Eve saw that their lives had drastically changed, and eventually they experienced physical death. It's just like Paul taught us in Romans. When I say Paul, the Apostle Paul, who wrote 13 letters in the New Testament, he says in Romans 5:12, therefore, just as through one man, that would be Adam, sin entered into the world, and death through sin. You see, further in Romans, he teaches that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All people are born separate from God and short of having a relationship restored with God. They will die physically and go into eternity still separate from God. Ezekiel 18:20 says, the person who sins will die. The son's not going to bear the punishment for the father's iniquity, nor will the father bear the punishment for the son's iniquity, but the person who sins will die. And you couple that with Paul's teaching in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's universal. It's affected us all. So all of us die. Sin's far more complicated than doing something bad. When we think of sin, we think of stealing or, you know, what do you think about when you think of sin? We usually think of some behavior, some bad thing. But I want to tell you something. When you think of sin, you need to think of it as like a disease that has contaminated us as human beings. It has literally contaminated us. We've caught it. All of us have it. We're born with it. It's a corrupting force that becomes part of our human makeup ever since Adam and Eve sinned in the garden. Sin is at the heart of every human being born on this planet, save one, Jesus Christ, born without sin, lived without ever sinning, and died a perfect man. We read, therefore, just as one through one man sin entered the world and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all have sinned. You don't become a sinner by sinning. Listen to me. You don't become a sinner by sinning. You sin because you are a sinner. The comparison between the first Adam and the last Adam, Jesus Christ, by Paul, affirms the historicity of Adam, that he's and was a human being. It requires that Adam be a literal ancestor of all humans whose sin really caused the introduction of death and the estrangement of humanity from God. It's all tied together, folks. It's one story. It's one book. You can't say, oh, I don't believe in the God of the Old Testament. He's harsh. I believe in the God of the New Testament, Jesus. He's just all love. I'm sorry, God is God. From beginning to end, just as Christ is a historical human being whose life of obedience to God and sacrificial death reconcile us to God and pay the sin debt in a way that no one else could, Adam was real. And that's why we're in the predicament we're in. The corruption of sin, when you think of it as a corrupting force in the human person, shades every faculty. The way we think is tainted by sin. The way that we live our lives is all tainted by sin. The way we love the ones that we love is stained with sin. We can't love perfectly. There's no escape from corrupting force of sin. If there was, we wouldn't have wars on earth. That's where they come from, is sin. That's why marriages fail. That's why children rebel. It all goes back to sin. And don't forget that the wages of sin, or the payment for sin, is death. Right? Sin is universal, therefore death is universal. You have it, I have it. And like an incurable disease, it's going to take everybody that has it straight to hell if nothing's done about it. This is why I've dedicated my life to preaching. Because when I was 19 years old, I found out there was an answer to this dilemma. And when they sang, "Hosanna, Hosanna," I was just rejoicing. It's like an anthem. It's triumphant. Save now. This is the situation for everybody alive according to the Bible. There's none that are righteous. No matter how good you are, you've still sinned. And that sin causes death. So you need to deal with your sin problem somehow. And it's not by the things that you do, because that doesn't erase the sin that you've committed. There is none that are righteous, not even one. And this is why we so celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The origin of life. Life is a gift from God. Physical life originated from God. Then the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. And this is so beautiful, so intimate. He breathed, bent down and breathed into the nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. Life came from God. Wasn't born in a test tube. It didn't fly to us on some particles of something or other that happened to come to Earth, wherever Earth came from. And voila, here we all are. Give me a break. I don't have that much faith. I really don't. And spiritual life, just like physical life, originates with God. Jesus explained to Nicodemus in John 3, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Later in the same gospel, he explained to his friend Martha, the sister of Lazarus, whom Jesus had just raised, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even if he dies. What's he talking about? Well, he's talking about spiritual life and physical death. Even if we die physically, we will still live if we believe in Jesus Christ. You understand that? He's not using doublespeak here. And everybody who lives and believes in me will never die. That's a promise. And God's either a liar, or this is true. I believe it to be very, very true. Life's more than life, just as death is more than death. Just as I explained that there's physical death and there's spiritual death, there's physical life and there's spiritual life. You can be alive physically, but dead spiritually. And there's a lot of dead men walking. A lot of dead men walking, spiritually speaking. Paul taught the Ephesians the truth by reminding the Ephesians that before their conversion, they were dead in their trespasses and sins. And yet, he's talking to people that were living physically, so he's talking spiritual death. They were dead in their trespasses and sins, separate from God. Paul taught the Ephesians the truth by reminding them they were dead in their trespasses and sins. But God, being rich in mercy, he continued to teach them, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, he's able to make us alive spiritually together with Christ. Why? Because it's by grace you've been saved and raised up with him. Oh man, hallelujah, praise God. Jesus Christ rose from the dead, which means if I believe in him, I have eternal life. Life's the gift of God, even as death is the wages of sin. Just as certain as physical death came into the world as a judgment on sin, as the wages of sin, so spiritual life is a gift of God to all who grasp that they need it. and repent of their sin. They turn away from their sin and they confess Jesus Christ to be their sinner, their Savior. John 5:25 says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming and now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live." You're listening to the voice of the Son of God through me this morning. If you're spiritually dead this morning, he's calling out to you, why will you die? Why will you go to hell? Why not believe in me and receive eternal life? The Son of God is able to impart spiritual life to those who are dead in their trespasses and sins. And this information, everything that I've said so far, is to help everybody understand what Resurrection Sunday is about. Why we celebrate Easter. And I know that's a pagan term. Get over it. What we're talking about is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Some people call it Easter. Remind them what Easter really is. It's the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it's a guarantee of eternal life, people. So far, we've seen what the Bible says about death, and that was kind of morose, physical and spiritual. We've seen physical death comes as a result of sin. It's a judgment on sin. And spiritual death is also a result of sin. And if a person dies physically while they're dead spiritually, they'll experience what the Bible calls a second death. And that's like, give me some good news. That is bad news, guaranteed. But there is good news. Because we read in the scripture, but God, who is the author of both physical and spiritual life, has made a way. He's made a provision that allows spiritually dead persons to be, as it were, born again. And Nicodemus was stumped when Jesus talked to him in John 3. He says, what, do I go back into my mother's womb? I had to laugh. Our two pregnant ladies in the choir were right up front. That was very gracious of them to put our two pregnant young ladies up front. What, we go back into the womb? Is that how we become born again? And Jesus is like, oh my gosh. How many times did Jesus think that, right? With his disciples? Okay, I got news for you. How many times does Jesus think that about us? Right? Oh my gosh. No, you don't go back into the womb. He's made it possible for sinful people, hell-deserving people, to become spiritually alive. And this is the reason we celebrate Resurrection Sunday. I read a post this week on Facebook. There's not very many posts anymore. I'm thinking of starting a campaign that you can't use emoticons anymore. You can't just like. You've got to actually make a comment. How lazy have we become? I mean, I put a post up and I expect to see something come back and I get like two responses and 75 checks. Doesn't do anything for me. I'm not enjoying that at all. So I'm just not going to post anything anymore. But I read this. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is a central event of God's redemptive history. It's central. Serving as proof that God has accepted Christ's sacrifice, I've already said that. It is the cornerstone of the Christian faith. Everything we are, everything we have, and everything we hope to be is dependent on the reality of Christ's resurrection. Just like Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, if he hasn't risen, we are of all people to be the most pitied because we are deceived, duped, and stupid. Right? If he's not raised, why would we live holy lives? Go out and get all the gusto you can and enjoy everything you possibly can. Revel in your sin, because you're going to die and go into the dirt and there's nothing left. And some people actually live like that, folks. People you know. May your joy abound as you consider his victory over sin. Let me break this down. One, every man, woman, and child born on this earth are born in a state of separation from God, the source of all life. Number two, God's holiness and righteousness demands that all sin be paid for by death. Okay? Number three, but God made a way for our sin to be paid for by the death of another, Jesus Christ. That's what we mean when we say the substitutionary atonement. That's a Greek big word for saying Jesus died in our place. He died for the sins of the world, but he died for your sins individually if you will but receive that gift and have eternal life. Number four, here it is, wait for it. On the third day after his death, he rose from the dead. He is risen. And right now, he's sitting in a glorified body. One that Thomas went in and put his fingers in the holes, okay? He's sitting in that glorified body at the right hand of the Father. I don't even know, I mean, go home today and just think about that for a little bit. And he is going to come back even as he left, which means that same body, he's going to come back to earth in someday. This is amazing stuff. He's risen. He's not here, for he's risen. And number five, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is witness that God the Father accepted his death for the penalty of sinful people so that we can have all of our sins forgiven. Romans 1:4 says that the Father declared Jesus to be the Son of God with power. The Father declared Jesus to be the Son of God with all power by the resurrection from the dead. Really important stuff, the resurrection. Finally, the implications of Jesus' resurrection. Courage and hope. Courage and hope. We've got the origin of death, the origin of life, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and now the so what? So what? What does it all mean? What does it mean to us? What difference does it all make? Well, Paul gave a succinct statement, and I read it during the pastoral meditation. If Christ has not been raised, my preaching's worthless. I might as well get a new job, right? Faith is worthless too. I'd be lying, everything I'm saying to you. You'd all still be in your sins as I would be, ready to face judgment for those sins if there is a God. And if there's no resurrection of the dead, then I'm not going to raise from the dead. And those who have all died before are not going to raise from the dead. And if we only hope in Christ in this life, then we're totally self-deceived and we're all men, of all men, most to be pitied. That's flawless logic. But Jesus did raise from the dead. I want to talk to you about the unimaginable courage and hope that we gain from the resurrection. And I want to use Peter and Paul as an illustration. Peter was that one disciple of Jesus that was always stepping into it, kind of impetuous, jumping into things all the time before he would think, and he would speak before he would think. But he really was quite a coward. Big strapping fisherman that he was. Because when Jesus, his Lord and Savior, was arrested, he had one incident where he cut off the high priest's ear and then got rebuked by Jesus, who took the ear, incidentally, put it back on and healed the man. You would think that that would do it, right? But the soldiers continued to arrest him. Amazing, that scene in the garden. Well, they say, who are you looking for? And looking for Jesus. And he says, I am. And they all fall over. They all fell over. And they got back up and like, whoo, what was that? And they arrested him. Okay? Peter then went on to follow him and seeing him being beaten and so forth, when asked by a little servant girl, who are you? He denied being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Three times he denied Christ. Three times. He was a coward. And then he ran away. They all ran away. Jesus died by himself, except for John was there. And so I want to use Peter because we see the courage just absolutely surging through this character, Peter. The first sermon that he preached is found in Acts chapter 2. You don't have to turn there. Just listen to me. The time frame, the sermon took place about 50 days after the Passover on a day called Pentecost. And Jesus had taught his disciples for 40 days leading up to that, after his resurrection, and then he ascended into heaven. And then 10 days after that ascension, he promised a comforter would come to the disciples and indwell them. And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost. And Peter got up, and we see unimaginable courage, because this is Peter, the one who denied Christ 3 times and ran away. And he gets up in front of everybody, and he preaches. And he said many things, but the crux of his message was the resurrection of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, as all the preaching of the apostles were in the book of Acts. It's the apostolic message of the gospel. It's what's called the good news. Okay? In each of these sermons that I'm going to just tell you about, you can go home and look at them, take the address down and look at them, and you'll see these salient points come out. In Acts 2:23, it identifies that Jesus died. He was nailed to a cross and put to death. He died. Verse 24 tells us of the resurrection. But God raised him up again. It's a contrast. He died, but God raised him up. And then verse 38 explains the forgiveness of sins. Quote, repent and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Died, rose again from the dead, so that we can have forgiveness of sins. It's the gospel. It's the good news. Peter then gave another sermon in Solomon's porch in the temple. Acts 3:11-20. This one was preached just after he and John had healed the lame man in a temple in Jerusalem, and everybody was amazed, so Peter got up to explain. The coward isn't cowardly anymore. What happened? Well, he had the Holy Spirit, and he knew that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. What can man do to me? Kill me. So what? That's what drove these men and women. Peter got up to explain what took place. In verse 15 of chapter 3, it identifies that Jesus, the holy and righteous one, they put to death the Prince of Life. I love that irony. They put to death the Prince of Life. And then verse 15, Peter asserts his resurrection, the one whom God raised from the dead. A fact, Peter says, to which we are witnesses. So either he's a bold-faced liar or he's telling the truth. He's telling the truth. In verse 19, Peter offers the forgiveness of sins. Therefore, repent and return so that your sins will be wiped away. People, I want to tell you, this is unimaginable hope. He's talking to Jewish people. They knew what sin was. They would do a morning and an evening sacrifice. Talk about Catholic guilt or Lutheran guilt. Okay? These Jews were under a heavy load of guilt. Jesus said to them, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy burden, and I will give you rest for your souls. Why? Because he knew they were under such burden of their sin. They were reminded every time they'd offer a sacrifice that they were sinners. And those sacrifices, incidentally, were only atonements. They were only coverings of the sin. Now Peter says, hey, the one whom God raised from the dead, a fact which we are witnesses, he did that so that your sins may be wiped out, not just covered over, taken away as far as the east is from the west. Don't get any further than that. That's like the zero with the rim knocked off. It's like they're gone. Completely gone, people. Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation. One of the funniest things that happened to me when I got converted, the very night I got converted, peace just flooded my soul, and I went to sleep with a smile on my face. And I've been smiling ever since. Because I know there's no condemnation. I don't have to worry anymore. He took it all. On the cross, he said, it is finished. So guess what? Steve's sins, past, present, and future, have all been borne by a Savior, somebody other than myself. And I don't have to worry about him because I'm trusting him and what the Bible says about him. And that's what Peter preached on that porch. Jesus, by his sacrifice, wiped away their sins. That's eternal hope, folks. The third sermon that I want to call your attention to is found in Acts 10, and Peter's at the home of Cornelius. Now, this is about between 7 and 10 years after Pentecost, okay? 7 to 10 years later, Peter's still preaching. That says something. And he's still very, very bold, and he's at a Gentile's house. The resurrection changes everything for both Jew and for the non-Jews, which would be us. We're not Jewish, most of us here. In chapter 10, verse 39, Peter tells these Gentiles, it was those in the land of the Jews who put Jesus to death. His own people rejected him and cried out, crucify him. That's not an anti-Semitic statement. The Romans are the ones that actually put him to death, but the Jews were calling for his death, and he came as their Messiah. In Acts 10:40, true to his model, Peter stresses the fact that they put him to death, but then there was a resurrection because Peter says, God raised him up on the third day. Death, resurrection. And then he goes on in 10:43, and as in his other sermons, Peter explains to Cornelius and all of his household that it is only through his name that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin. Death, resurrection, sins wiped out, forgiveness of sins. Now, one final sermon, and we're done. Paul in Antioch, a Pisidian. 18 years after the crucifixion, Paul's preaching. Paul was Saul. This is 8 years after Peter talked to Cornelius. And Saul, the persecutor, is now Paul, the preacher. And he and Barnabas, son of encouragement, on their first missionary journey, and they're at Antioch of Pisidian, located in south central Turkey of today, just to give you an idea where they were, Paul held true to the apostolic message. Listen to what he said. In 1327, what a note to complacency here. The apostles were sent out with this message of salvation because those who lived in Jerusalem were, the temple was, even though they listened to the words of the prophets every Sabbath, they recognized neither Jesus nor the words of the prophets about him. And so the apostles went out, the disciples went out from Jerusalem and began to spread the word where people would listen. In Acts 13:28, we read, Paul says that they asked Pilate to execute Jesus, destroy him, kill him. And in Acts 13:30, just like Peter in his message, Paul then explained that God raised him from the dead. You've got to die in order to get raised from the dead. So there you have the death, and you have the resurrection, don't you? And in 1338, here's the result of such preaching to everybody who believes that through him, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. It is so clear, people. It is so clear. And it's so simple. The thing that makes it complex is our own sinfulness because we're so proud we don't want to humble ourselves and say, we need a Savior. That's what makes it hard. That's why I don't believe that any proofs are going to lead somebody to Jesus Christ. They might take some hurdles out of the way, but you can't logic somebody into the kingdom because it comes to the bottom line where they just have to give up and say, I believe. I believe. The apostles' preaching leaves no doubt about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and through their words of the Bible, the implications for us of both courage and hope. Romans 1:4 states that God the Father declared him to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection of the dead. So that's his identity and that's his approval. Romans 4:24 says this, 25, links our justification with the resurrection. He who was delivered over because of our transgressions, our sins, Jesus, and was raised because of our justification. Justification is a big theological word that just means that when we believe in Jesus Christ, we're justified. That means that God the Father declares us righteous. So that when God the Father sees you from the moment you believe, he sees you no longer as a sinner. He sees his Son, Jesus Christ in your place. That's huge. That'll put a smile on your face. 1 Peter 1:3 identifies our regeneration to be linked to the resurrection. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope. Courage and hope. A living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. 1 Corinthians 15:20, we will experience resurrection ourselves because of his resurrection. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. I'd pray that today you'd examine your heart on Resurrection Sunday 2017 and take the truth of the death and resurrection and complete forgiveness of sins. Take it to be your own. Embrace it. Not just cognitively, but volitionally. Humble yourself before another who took your place on the cross and paid for your sins. It's Jesus' voice today to you. Whoever believes in me, I will in no ways cast out. You don't have to be a theologian. You don't have to have all sorts of Bible study or catechism to believe. You can do it right now in the quietness of your own heart and make this the most wonderful Resurrection Sunday you've ever had in your life. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your word. We're grateful for the way that you have put it together for us to remind us of everything that you have done on our behalf. And I pray, God, that you would please make this real to anyone here this morning that is one of those people that are dead in trespasses and sins, that they might have eternal life, even this morning. And we'll always be able to point back to Resurrection Sunday 2017 as the day that they first believed. For the rest of us, Lord, let us rejoice and revel in the sheer joy of having all of our sins forgiven, past, present, and future, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.